My next guest absolutely blew me away from the first note she sang, and she'll do it again tonight when she sings here the incredible Susan Boyle coming up. Susan Boyle burst onto the scene 2 years ago on Britain's Got Talent. No one expected much. When she opened her mouth to sing, wow. I was a judge that night, and it was one of the most extraordinary things I've ever witnessed. Susan's voice captivated all of us, and then the whole world. Her first album went to number one globally. Her second also went to number one globally. She sold 14 million copies in 14 months. And her third, Someone to Watch Over Me, is released this week and is already riding high up the charts. Susan, welcome.
Hello.
Who would have thought 2 years ago that you and I would be sitting here in Hollywood from a position where you were a complete unknown, coming on this talent show, hoping for the best, not knowing what would happen, and now you're 15 million albums later. Can you believe it?
It's still pretty much surreal.
Well, you did do an interview with my predecessor, Larry King. And the reason I know that is that I also appeared on it. And we have a clip to play you. This is before the end of Britain's Got Talent. So you'd already done the audition, which had gone around the world, but you hadn't actually got to the final yet. Let's watch a bit of this. And I'd like to say, Susan, I was very touched by the very flattering remarks you made about me in the newspapers at the weekend, which did not go unnoticed, particularly as you chose me over Simon as your potential suitor. And I would like to extend an invitation to you to have dinner with me in London, Susan.
I accept. Oh, my God.
We've never actually had our dinner date, have we?
Hmm.
I still owe you that dinner. What do you think when you look at yourself back then? What do you think?
I think, oh my God, what a prat.
Now, I've got a bone to pick with you because our ongoing frisson, mm-hmm. I think is mm-hmm. the best way of mm-hmm. describing it, I had to turn on a rival show mm-hmm. the other morning and I witnessed a scene that I wasn't happy about, Susan. I'm going to play this to you and then remonstrate with you afterwards.
From Susan Boyle, and she's gonna sing a little later too.
Maybe a duet the way this thing is going.
Wow, get a little close there. Hey, we're gonna get
what the hell are you doing with Bill Cosby? I thought I was the man in your life.
Aha! Well, I'll be revealed later, my dear.
I mean, I love watching that because apart from the fact you seem so relaxed, the fact that you're just cavorting with one of the most famous television stars of all time. Again, you must feel like pinching yourself, don't you?
Well, you still get that fight. He's a lovely man. A nice guy. He's a nice guy. Let yourself.
Yeah, I don't want to get into a battle with Bill Cosby.
You don't.
I would lose.
Oh, shame.
Tell me about the new album.
The new album is Someone to Watch Over Me. It's a reflective album consisting of a variety of songs to suit all ages.
I know your manager very well. He's a lovely guy, and he's taken great care of you. And he said to me, I think after the first album would be number one all around the world, and he said, the really interesting thing about Susan, unlike everyone he worked with, from George Michael onwards, all the great singers he's worked with, mm-hmm. is that you had no knowledge of or interest in how many records you'd sold or how much money you'd made. It just didn't interest you.
I just love the job too much.
Do you know now? I mean, do you ever look at charts? Do you ever ask how you're doing?
Every artist does have that wee bit where they like to be the best at it.
So you've now got a little bit more competitive, have you?
It's the name of the game.
Because at the moment, you're in a head-to-head battle, I think, with Justin Bieber.
Oh, he's a lovely boy.
Yeah, but you want to take him down, don't you?
He's a lovely boy.
Come on, Susan.
He's a lovely boy. I'm not going to commit myself.
Written in your eyes there. You're about to say, I'm going to smack down the Bieber boy.
He's a lovely boy. He's got a good, great voice. Lovely person. I'd love to adopt him, actually. He's a good boy.
You'd adopt him? That's a good idea.
Yeah, I'll adopt him. Why not?
He's quite adoptable, isn't he?
He's lovable. He's lovable.
So if he's watching, you would happily take him under your wing?
Yeah, got a banter with him. There you go.
I mean, you grew up in this little village in Scotland. Not many people live there. It was not, as people like to say, an unhappy upbringing. You were very happy, actually, for most of your life before you came on Britain's Got Talent. We've discussed that. But
still
are. Yeah, and the key person in your life was your mother, who very sadly died really before she saw any of this. What would your mother have made of this, do you think?
Now, that's a bit of a tricky one. But she probably would have said, stop all the nonsense and just get on with it. That's what she would have said.
What were the values she taught you?
Christian values. How to put yourself in other people's shoes. And how to give of your best. Even when things would be tough.
Well, you certainly did that. And you entered Britain's Got Talent. And after the break, I want to show you the clip that the whole world watched. The famous audition clip where I was there. And I'll be honest, laughing at you. But I wasn't laughing once you began to sing. You had the last laugh.
Little devil. Like little devil.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
A moment, Susan Boyle's audition for Britain's Got Talent. I actually had a lump in my throat there, Susan. The moment that you finished and the audience in Scotland rose as one, 3,000 people roaring from the rooftops, and the judges all gave you these rave reviews and stuff. Mm-hmm. That must have been for you, for, you know, you were 47 years old at the time. Mm-hmm. You'd lived this dream all your life, and in that moment, you must have felt, I don't know, how did you feel?
I felt very pleased. I was quite frightened. I was usually go, will you get off? You're making a fool of yourself. But it was quite something to be accepted. I felt accepted. And the warmth from the audience really made me feel accepted.
Because although you'd had a good upbringing and were very close to your mother and so on, and loved by many people, but you had had a lot of bullying when you were at school and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I suspect there was a sense of vindication, wasn't there, that went with all the other feelings you were feeling of, I've just got one back at those people that bullied me.
Well, it said it in the album, You'll See, was one of the albums I did, one of the songs, and the song You'll See summed it all up. And I've since had very nice relationships with some of them who have been bullies, have grown up.
Really?
That's a happy ending, you know.
They contacted you too, and they said sorry for what they did?
Some of them have. Some of them... I mean, you lose contact with some of them, but those who have contacted me have just been okay. They've grown up. They're just silly kids. They're silly kids.
When the audition got aired on television, I remember it because Simon Cowell and I spoke. He was here, I was in London, and both our phones were going off the hook. Mm-hmm. And we hadn't predicted this at all. Mm-hmm. We thought it would be a good moment in the show, but not necessarily even the best moment of that night. Mm-hmm. By the next day, you'd had a million hits on YouTube. By the end of the week, 10 million. By the week after, 100 million. It became, the statistics are incredible. I think 300 million hits on YouTube at its peak. It was the most downloaded clip in the world, mm-hmm. 2009. Mm-hmm. And then I Dreamed a Dream, US album numbers. 701,000 copies sold in its first week. The biggest opening week for a debut artist in over a decade. You beat Eminem, who only sold 608,000 that week.
Good.
Your second biggest selling album of 2009 in America, just behind Taylor Swift. Stuff of dreams, isn't it?
It is, yeah. Is someone kidding me? That's what it feels like. Is someone kidding me?
Does it still feel like that?
It does a bit. It does a bit. I guess I'll grow into it.
What's been your biggest pinch me moment of them all?
I think you could have to say meeting Donny Osmond.
Meeting Donny Osmond, really?
Why not?
Because you've got a big soft spot for him, haven't you?
Oh, I certainly have, yeah.
And he's a lovely guy, isn't he?
He is, he's really nice.
I mean, he's as nice, really, in private as he is in public.
Very family orientated, I think. Very, yeah. Very grounded.
Have you sung with Donny yet?
Not yet.
You sang for the Pope.
That was extra special, but that's something that was really private for me.
Yeah, because you're a Catholic. I mean, of course, a big moment.
You know, and that's not something you get to do in a lifetime, twice. And when they said to me I was going to meet the Pope, I said, it was a bit overwhelming. Mm. You know, I kissed his ring. It was really an emotional moment, something I'll never forget.
Do you know how much money you made? Have you any idea?
Maybe £500. I don't know.
You could afford to live here in Hollywood and in some huge mansion, but that doesn't interest you, does it?
I believe in being a normal person. I believe in being a person who's an entertainer. Because you're mixing with people all the time and you're in a close-knit community. Mm. You come away from that glitzy bit and you become a normal person. I like that transition.
What's the ambition now? You've obviously realised the original ambition. What's the next ambition for you?
My ambition is to be continuing in what I'm doing, continue to make people happy, and I hope for as long as it lasts, the public can continue accepting me the way they do.
Well, I don't have to worry on that score, Susan. It's been a great pleasure for me and a privilege to have seen somebody that I saw on that day in Scotland, the first audition, and we had that magical moment together and with the other people who were there. And to see you now, you know, third album, possibly, you know, by the time this airs even, maybe number one again in America, three on the bounce. Very few people in history have ever achieved that. It's a remarkable achievement. Well, good luck, yeah, because you've got the little Bieber man to see off.
That's lovely. That's lovely. Yes, it's lovely.
Susan, good luck. It's been a pleasure seeing you. And I wish you all the very best. I believe you're now going to do a little performance for me.
Yeah.
Of the singing variety, right?
Oh, you naughty bugger. It's called Both Says No. It's from the album Summer to Autumn.
Great. We'll take a break. And when we come back, Susan Boyle will sing. Thank you very much. Lovely to see you. Performing Both Sides Now from her third album, Someone to Watch Over Me, the great Susan Boyle.
It's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life. I really don't know life at all.